This meeting is now being recorded.
Well, good evening. Welcome to the EDS Awareness Educational Series webinar. My name is John Furman. Before we introduce our speaker, we'd like to give an overview of our free program for those attending for the first time. We're going to go over who are we, what is our program, some upcoming events, introduce Dr. Peter Rowe, our speaker for this evening, and then we'll have a Q&A. So again, my name is John Furman. I manage the National EDS Awareness Program based in Cincinnati, Ohio. My daughter, Deanna, leads the Cleveland, Ohio EDS Support Group. She was diagnosed with EDS in 2008, the same year my wife passed away with breast cancer. I was a caregiver for my wife who struggled with undiagnosed EDS for over 30 years. We introduced our program at the 2012 EDNF conference to help EDSers form independent local support groups and spread EDS awareness in their communities. We've started over 45 groups to date. Each group is given their own free website with a link to the directory and map. Last week, we attended as a sponsor of the EDS conference in Houston for the third time. There was a great response for our program. We'll be adding over 20 groups to our site, some in U.S., Australia, New Zealand, and one in Mexico City, and another one in Canada. But we've received feedback that conferences provide valuable information and social opportunities that many cannot afford physically or financially to attend in person. So we decided to bring the speakers to you through the free EDS Awareness Educational Series. We meet every first and third Wednesday, typically at 7:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. All the programs are free. The meeting announcements and, when possible, the webinar recordings will be posted on our site at edsawareness.com for later replay. You can receive email announcements for future sessions by requesting the free report on our site. Tonight's presentation is sponsored by Body Support Store, where you will find over 250 products selected by EDSers for EDSers. The store is the only funding for this program and usually covers our monthly web fees. So just a general disclaimer, this presentation contains general information about EDS. Members of the EDS community voluntarily participate in this program. The information is not advice. If you are having medical problems now, please call 911 and get the services that you need. Always consult your doctor before making any changes to your treatment.
Our speaker for August 6th is Dr. Derek Nielsen of the Cincinnati Children's Hospital. The title of his talk is Proving the Obvious, Next Steps for the Demystification of Ehlers-Danlos Hypermobility Type. Our speaker tonight is Dr. Peter Rowe, and he's going to talk about managing orthostatic intolerance in EDS. Dr. Rowe is a professor of pediatrics at the Johns Hopkins Children's Center in Baltimore. He graduated from the McMaster University Medical School in Canada and was a chief resident in pediatrics at the Johns Hopkins Hospital, a staff member at the Children's Hospital of Eastern Ontario, and assistant professor in epidemiology and community medicine and of pediatrics. Dr. Rowe returned to Johns Hopkins University in 1991, and he's very well published with over 60 peer-reviewed papers and 10 book chapters. After the presentation, there's an opportunity for Q&A. add your questions at any time during the presentation by clicking the Q&A icon at the top of your screen. After typing your question, click the orange button to submit. And this time, I'd like to welcome Dr. Rowe. We're looking forward to hearing your presentation, and you'll see your slides are loaded on the screen now. I'm going to go ahead and turn the microphone over to you.
Great. Thank you very much for the invitation, Deanna and John. I'm pleased to join everybody tonight. Are you hearing me okay?
Yes, you sound wonderful.
Okay, great. I think my mouse has frozen, so I'm not sure how we'll do with advancing these.
If you would like, I could advance them for you. Just tell me what works for you.
We may need to do that. My screen just went blank. Oh, goodness. Windows has decided to log off and unlock the machine and lock the machine. I'm very sorry. I'm not sure what happened just then. Oh, goodness. John, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
My screen is frozen, and I can't get it to come up. So I'm going to try and reboot. I'm very sorry. I'm not sure what's going on.
That's fine.
I can do that. Okay, hold on.
All right. So while Dr. Rowe's rebooting, I just wanted to tell you a little bit about the conference in, no, I don't sing, so you don't want me to sing. But we did have a great conference in Houston, and a number of people that are on the call were there as well. And we had a number of good speakers. In fact, that's a great area for opportunity for us to recruit speakers for the conference. And the speaker on August 6th, Dr. Nielsen, is actually from Cincinnati, and he has agreed to give a presentation. He's a geneticist, and he's from Cincinnati Children's Hospital, and I'm here in Cincinnati, so that's a really good opportunity. Some others around this area, too. We have other speakers lined up. Dr. Posinki is going to be coming onto the call after that. So we have probably about a dozen doctors that we're going to be adding to our calls in the near future. Sometimes we have these technical difficulties, and we appreciate your patience as Dr. Rowe reboots his computer and gets his slides back up. So I'm glad the audio is good. And as I mentioned, we were really excited. There was a group from New Zealand that was there, and they've agreed to join our group, so we'll be putting them on the map. We do have one group in Australia, and we'll be adding another group as well, so that's really exciting. We're going to have
John,
to call this.
It's Peter. I'm back on.
Fabulous.
Okay. So, sorry for that. I'm not sure what happened at my end, but as soon as the slides came up, they went black. Let's see. John, I don't see the, hang on. There we go.
Okay.
Just What's that?
That is, we'll let you go. I'm going to end Lovell.
Okay. Very good. So I wanted to mention that I don't have any financial relationships with drug companies or other things that would create a conflict of interest. We will be discussing some medications that are off-label, but most of them have been supported by short-term physiology studies at a bare minimum. Here's what I want to talk about tonight. This is an issue that we've been working on in the setting of chronic fatigue syndrome for about 20 years now, and on the combination of EDS and orthostatic intolerance for the past 15. So I thought it would be helpful to just go over the definition of orthostatic intolerance, walk through a bit of the physiology of the disorder so we're on the same page with understanding what's happening, discuss the common forms of orthostatic intolerance that people with EDS will be diagnosed with, look at the connection among the three big topics of chronic fatigue syndrome, orthostatic intolerance, and EDS, and then I'll go on to talk about treatment of the disorder of the orthostatic intolerance, first looking at things that do not require medications, moving on to treat contributory conditions, and then talk about different medications that we can use. So, to begin with, the term orthostatic intolerance refers to a group of clinical conditions. So there are several things that can create this. And they're defined by having symptoms that worsen with quiet upright posture, and that can include sitting or standing. And they are ameliorated but not necessarily abolished by lying back down. And this is a definition I've modified from the group at the Mayo Clinic. Here's another slide from one of Philip Lowe's chapters from the Mayo Clinic describing the big challenge that we face when we stand up. If we move from the supine position shown on the left hand in this slide to standing, the big challenge is that there's a gravitational pooling of about 500 to 750 milliliters of our blood volume. The cartoon doesn't really well illustrate that a fair bit of the pooling of blood occurs in the abdominal circulation, but it does show nicely the amount of pooling in the legs and any area below the heart. If we stand up with the blood in a different position, initially there's a drop in the arterial blood pressure, and there are very tightly organized sensors in the circulatory system, especially in the big vessels, and these are termed baroreceptors. They are used to a certain amount of stretch, and if blood pressure goes down, the baroreceptors are not being stretched as much. That sends an immediate message through the nerves to the parts of the brain that control circulation. And then the consequence is that there's a big increase in the autonomic nervous system's sympathetic nerve activity. Many people know this, the sympathetic nervous system, as the fight or flight arm of the autonomic nervous system. And so the nerves result in a bit of an increase in heart rate. For most of us, it's about a 15 to 20 beat increase in heart rate when we stand. There's a little bit more vigorous contraction of the ventricles of the heart, so the amount of blood that's pumped goes up a bit. But the biggest change is that this sympathetic nerve activity results in some vasoconstriction, some blood vessel constriction, that then sends the blood that has pooled in the limbs back up to the heart. So that's what normally happens. If that doesn't happen efficiently, then these are the symptoms that result. These are the symptoms of orthostatic intolerance. The ones on this side, on the left, refer to symptoms that you can imagine are due to inadequate blood flow getting to the brain. Most people have felt lightheadedness at some point in their life when they go from kneeling to standing quickly. So lightheadedness reflects the reduction in brain blood flow. Syncope, or fainting, is the more extreme version of that. But almost everybody who has reduced blood flow to the brain gets diminished concentration or short-term memory problems, the sorts of things that we often joke about as being ADD, or attention deficit disorder. And these are very common and similar between those with orthostatic intolerance and people with attentional problems. Headache is a very common symptom of orthostatic intolerance, as is blurred vision. And in just about every report you read about the different kinds of orthostatic intolerance, people who have it report very high rates of fatigue and difficulty tolerating normal exercise. On the right, on this side of the slide, you get a variety of symptoms that can be related to the body's response to the inadequate blood flow to the brain, and that involves a big increase in epinephrine, which is also known as adrenaline, and norepinephrine. One of the interesting features in orthostatic intolerance is a shortness of breath. This isn't a panic problem. It's an increase in people feel a sense that they are having a hard time getting air in. And with that, you can often see chest discomfort, palpitations or skipped beats, tremulousness, anxiety, nausea even, and some people have a lot of waking up at night to urinate. So these features tend to be a bit more related to the high levels of catecholamines, the epinephrine and norepinephrine. Well, let's look at the common forms of orthostatic intolerance that we typically see. I've shown them on this slide, and we'll look at these in a bit more detail in a bit. The two most common ones that I see in my Ehlers-Danlos patients are neurally mediated hypotension, or NMH for short, and POTS, or postural tachycardia syndrome. The pattern of response of blood pressure and heart rate differs for these two problems when you either stand or get on a tilt table. In NMH, heart rate here in black goes up less than 30 beats per minute. Patients usually have reproduction of symptoms, and then at a certain point, they have a profound and sudden drop in blood pressure to the point where they're not getting adequate blood flow to the brain, and they lose consciousness. In people with POTS, you can see the blood pressure here on the top is the systolic. This is the diastolic pressure. The blood pressure is relatively well maintained, at least early on. And what you see instead is a tremendous increase in heart rate immediately upon standing. And we define POTS as being present if the heart rate goes up 30 beats per minute from the resting supine rate, or 40 beats per minute in adolescence. And it has to involve a reproduction of the person's typical symptoms of lightheadedness and other orthostatic symptoms. On this slide, what I've done is summarize a lot of the physiologic literature on these disorders, and I want to make a couple of points. The problems can be thought of in a fairly simplified manner if you think of these disorders of orthostatic intolerance as involving some increase in pooling in the limbs or an inability to properly vasoconstrict, to have those blood vessels tighten up and send the blood back up to the heart. And many people have a reduction, for reasons that are not well known, in their intravascular volume. So it's as if the system doesn't have enough fluid in it and also has too much of it in the wrong places, in the lower half of the body. So when people then stand or have a tilt test, there's an exaggerated sympathoadrenal response. This refers to the sympathetic nervous system as well as the adrenal release of epinephrine. Dr. David Goldstein, who's a specialist in these disorders at the NIH, thinks that if you have a greater amount of norepinephrine released from the nerves than epinephrine from the adrenal glands, that because norepinephrine is a better vasoconstrictor, then you maintain your blood pressure and the pattern you get that we can measure is more like pots. Whereas if you have more epinephrine released, that causes a bit of dilation of some of the arterial beds, and that is thought to lead to fainting or the neurally mediated hypotension. And I have taken the position, as Dr. Goldstein has, that POTS and NMH are not vastly different. They are along a spectrum of orthostatic intolerance. And many of our patients with POTS early in a tilt test, if we keep them upright, will eventually develop the NMH pattern. The good thing is we don't have to be splitters here. We can lump them because the treatments are virtually identical, regardless of whether you have POTS or NMH. Let's go into a little bit about how what we mean by neurally mediated hypotension. This is a disorder or a condition with a number of synonyms in medicine. Some people call it vasovagal syncope. Many of you will have heard the term neurocardiogenic syncope or vasodepressor syncope, and some think that it has a lot of overlap with something called delayed orthostatic hypotension. Orthostatic hypotension is a common form of orthostatic intolerance in older people, and it refers to a drop of 20 millimeters of mercury in the blood pressure, systolic blood pressure, within 3 minutes of standing. So these people get a very abrupt drop in blood pressure. Neurally mediated hypotension tends to occur some minutes after that, in our studies at a median of about 28 minutes of upright tilt testing. This is the most common cause of recurrent syncope. It's more common in women, which is one of the interesting features when you look at this in conjunction with patients who have both chronic fatigue syndrome and EDS. It's more common in younger people and in people who start off with a low normal or low blood pressure. It can be seen in the midst of something like influenza or other kinds of infection. It's common within families, and usually the routine physical examination and the laboratory tests are normal. So that led to many people being missed. And in fact, you can't detect the hypotension unless you put people in a standing posture or a tilted posture for a prolonged period of time. Usually with tilt table testing, we typically keep people up for at least 45 minutes. One of the interesting things that struck us when we started working on this was that in the original report of vasovagal syncope, same thing, back in about 1930, the soldier who was being described as having fainted had tremulousness and exhaustion for 72 hours after his episode of fainting, suggesting that fatigue is one of the consequences of somehow triggering this reflex pathway in the nervous system. This slide gives you a bit of a sense of how people think things happen. If you are tilted upright, and by the tilt test, I mean a table that has a footboard for weight bearing, and the person is brought to a nearly standing position, usually 70 degrees upright. So with that, you get the pooling that I talked about. There is a reduction in the amount of venous blood that returns to the heart, and then you see this drop in blood pressure that we talked about earlier. The body responds with an increase in catecholamines. And those of us who do any exercise know that when you're running and you have a higher level of catecholamines, you get an increased forcefulness, referred to as inotropy, and an increased forcefulness of the heartbeat, and an increase in the heart rate. In the setting of an underfilled ventricle of the heart, because of all the pooling of blood in the limbs, this increase in catecholamines causes these forceful contractions. And this is thought to lead to a reflex that gets transmitted to the brain, as if the heart is sensing that all of these catecholamines causing it to pump vigorously are an indication that blood pressure might be too high. The brain then receives this message and does what's entirely appropriate for treating blood pressure that's elevated. It tries to lower heart rate, and it withdraws the sympathetic nervous system tone, leading to blood vessels to vasodilate. So if you happened to be hypertensive and at risk of having a stroke, this would be an ideal reflex response. But because patients trigger this reflex at a time when they're really struggling to get blood flow to the brain, this reflex pathway eventually leads to low blood pressure, and if they don't sit down or lie down, they faint. Okay, so here's the thing that we see. This is an older tilt table that we had in the early 90s, and this is a young woman on the left who had been fainting at college when she would stand in the hallway talking to her friends in their dorm room. She ignored some of the lightheadedness that she was developing and didn't want to leave the conversation, so she would lose consciousness. Here she is immediately on being tilted upright, and you can see she's looking pretty happy. About 5 minutes in, she's feeling quite symptomatic, and you can see her face looking a bit less happy with us. And here she has totally fainted and lost all of her muscle tone. She's kept in by these straps. And this is the hand of the technician reaching over to the crank to put the table down at that point. So we're looking for a lot of these kinds of responses, but importantly, the provocation of symptoms. Here's a close-up of the earlier slide showing this, in this case, a medical student who was tilted upright to 70 degrees. Heart rate and blood pressure were fine when she was lying flat. With the upright tilt, her heart rate went up only 9 beats. She was lightheaded and pale immediately. And then suddenly at the 6-minute point, which is actually a very early time for this reflex to occur, blood pressure fell precipitously. Her systolic pressure went down below about 50. Diastolic couldn't be recorded. And normally, if a healthy person has some kind of big drop in their blood pressure, their heart rate ought to go sky high to compensate. And in this reflex, the characteristic changes for heart rate to drop down. So this, she even had some tonic-clonic seizure movements on the way down flat. That is of no prognostic consequence, but it lets you know that there's been a brief interruption of blood flow to the brain. One thing that we see in both the patients with NMH and POTS is a very striking color change in the limbs. This is called dependent acrocyanosis. Cyanosis is the medical term for the purple discoloration. And here is the hand of a young college student that came to see me because of fatigue and lightheadedness. This is about 3 minutes into her tilt test, and that's my hand in the background for a comparison of the color. It was a standing test. And then we were struck by how much purple discoloration she had in her legs. So I went over and put my fingers here where you can see these three white areas, stepped back, picked up a camera, and I can tell this audience will appreciate that I'm not the savviest guy technically. So it took a while for me to focus the camera and take the picture. And still she had no blood return back to this area that had been compressed. So this is a really dramatic thing that we often see in the peripheral circulation of people with these disorders. Let's go on to POTS for a bit. This is not a new syndrome, but it's certainly being increasingly recognized these days. It had been described as early as the Civil War era and was termed irritable heart syndrome. After World War I, it was termed Effort Syndrome, and during the first half of the 20th century, it was often called neurocirculatory asthenia, or weakness. It has a prominent female-to-male ratio, usually about 4-1. It's uncommon but not unheard of under the age of 10. It tends to begin after the beginning of the pubertal growth surge. The onset can be quite gradual in some patients, but it can also appear abruptly. And in Ron Schondorf's original description of POTS in the early 1990s, several of the patients that he had seen had had this begin after an apparent viral infection. People have described it after other stressors like immunization, surgery, or trauma, and we're not entirely sure why each one is a trigger, but many of them are problems that provoke some degree of inactivity. It's become clear as people look at the quality of life in those with POTS that symptoms of this disorder can be quite disabling. And as I mentioned, there's been a marked change in the recognition and incidence of this problem in the last 10 or 20 years. I don't remember seeing anyone or recognizing anyone with this in the early 80s when I was in my training period. But last summer, we were getting 50 requests for new consultation per week. So something has really changed in the population, and I don't think it's simply better recognition. I mentioned earlier that we have to have different definitions of POTS for adults and adolescents. For adults, it's a 30-beat change in heart rate, and in adolescents, it's a 40-beat change, or any heart rate above 120 beats per minute. And this has to happen in the first 10 minutes of standing or head-up tilt with the provocation of symptoms. So let's move now to talk a bit about the interaction between chronic fatigue syndrome, orthostatic intolerance, and EDS. We got interested in this when I was running a diagnostic problems clinic in the pediatric department at Johns Hopkins in the early 90s. And one of the interesting things was that I was being asked to see kids who had both chronic fatigue syndrome and those who had had spells of fainting. This was an era right after the introduction of tilt table testing for the recognition and treatment or diagnosis of syncopal syndromes. And it really helped those patients, many of whom had been ignored or patted on the head and told things like, "Aren't you lucky, dear? Your blood pressure's so low that you'll never have a stroke." Well, that completely ignored what people were coming in complaining about, usually fatigue and lightheadedness and poor quality of life. What we noticed was that in my clinic, we had an opportunity to see people with chronic fatigue syndrome back-to-back with the recurrent fainters and realized that those with chronic fatigue were becoming tired and lightheaded in positions of quiet, upright posture. So they would get fatigued just standing in line waiting for the bus, standing in line waiting for their driver's license to be renewed when we did it that way. So we started thinking maybe we can do tilt table testing in these kids with chronic fatigue and see if they have the same problem. And in fact, this small case series looked at seven patients who had either chronic fatigue or chronic fatigue syndrome, and all seven had profound hypotension on the tilt table testing, and some of them had marked increases in heart rate. We made mention of the fact that it overlapped with postural tachycardia syndrome in that paper. And then we went on to look at whether this could be confirmed in a larger group of patients who had full-blown chronic fatigue syndrome. So this was a study that we started as a pilot to try and get a sense of how many people might have this hypotension, and we needed that information to begin a randomized trial. It turned out that, that one of the things that was interesting is that when we looked at these 23 adolescents and adults that had chronic fatigue syndrome, things that worsened their fatigue included physical exertion, which is one of the defining elements of the CFS case criterion, but also things like a hot shower, prolonged standing, a warm environment, all of which are bad for fainters. And hearkening back to that soldier in the 1930s who fainted and was tired for 72 hours, these people were reporting that they were much more tired after they became lightheaded. So we did, too heavy-handed there. We did a three-stage tilt test at that point. Stage one involved 45 minutes of upright posture at 70 degrees, and if they tolerated that, the table was put back down to a flat position, and in stage two, they went upright again for 15 minutes while receiving an adrenaline-like material called isoproterenol. And isoproterenol was used to raise the heart rate about 20%, and in some ways it simulates some of the standard stresses of day-to-day life. In stage three, after they've been tolerated stage two for 15 minutes, they were put back down and then put up for another 10 minutes with a higher dose of isoproterenol. Now, if you keep raising the dose of isoproterenol, everybody faints. So the problem is you have to look at stage three tilt tests with some caution. In our 14 controls, we started being able to provoke hypotension in the controls when we started them on isoproterenol, even more so on the higher dose of isoproterenol. But in stage one, when it was just 45 minutes of standing, the controls were largely bored and had normal blood pressure. In dramatic contrast, the CFS patients developed hypotension in 16 out of 23. And then as we added isoproterenol, we provoked hypotension in most of the others. Only one person was hemodynamically normal. So this was a highly significant difference. And even though we had intended this just as a pilot study, it was strong enough that we felt compelled to publish it, and it was accepted in the Journal of the American Medical Association. And the odds ratio for having an abnormal tilt in those with chronic fatigue syndrome was 55. To put that in perspective, the odds ratio for getting cancer if you're a lifetime smoker is about 3. So this was a huge risk factor. We also noticed that during the tilt test, even in stage one before everybody had dropped their blood pressure, everybody complained of increased fatigue. So just being upright, and they were being supported by this table. They weren't actively standing. They were tired, lightheaded. They felt hot flashes, nauseous, and sweaty. These are features that are probably quite familiar to any of you who have orthostatic intolerance. What got a lot of people's attention with this paper is that we then went on to say, all right, if they've got the hypotension, why don't we treat them with the medicines that cardiologists use to treat recurrent fainting, like fludrocortisone or florinef, beta blockers, midodrine, and a couple of others. And what we were struck by was that when we asked them how they were feeling initially using a wellness score, a general sense of well-being that's anchored at 0, and we asked them, how are you feeling in the last month, let's say? And 0 means that I feel like I'm dying, and 100 means that I feel about as good as I could imagine feeling. So these CFS patients came in with scores of about 35 on this wellness score. Think of it as like a percentage of normal. And with these treatments of orthostatic intolerance, they improved to a mean of about 70, which was a pretty substantial change over a couple of months. And that continues to be our experience to this day. Since 1995, a number of others have replicated these results, and the majority of the studies, with a couple of exceptions in small research-oriented groups, the majority of the studies show that orthostatic intolerance of one form or another is strongly associated with chronic fatigue syndrome. We know that upright posture consistently aggravates CFS symptoms, and the symptom changes, as we originally saw, often occur before you see the changes in heart rate and blood pressure. In a subset, and I don't mean by any stretch to suggest that this is all patients, but in a fairly large subset of those with CFS, treating the orthostatic intolerance is associated with an improvement in CFS symptoms and function. And so we've felt for a long time that recognizing and treating orthostatic intolerance gives people an avenue for a pragmatic and individualized way of treating the symptoms in people who have chronic fatigue syndrome. Okay, so you're on this EDS awareness call and you're wondering, what in the world does this have to do with EDS? Well, we know from Peter Byton's description of the Ehlers-Danlos syndromes in 1997, there was a sentence that said that for those with classical EDS, fatigue is a frequent complaint. And in many genetic monographs on Ehlers-Danlos syndrome before the 1990s, people would write that people with EDS have fatigue and widespread pain as if it was a constant feature of the syndrome and that there was very little one could do about it. When this was revisited by a Dutch group in 2010, of their 273 EDS subjects, 77% reported severe fatigue, and for over half of them, fatigue was one of the three most important symptoms. What was interesting in their paper was that severe fatigue was more common in the hypermobile than in the classical EDS patients. That wasn't strikingly significant, but interesting. We then went on to describe the overlap of EDS, CFS, and orthostatic intolerance in a paper in 1999 where we said that these three things overlapped. We went on to show that about 60% of our CFS patients met criteria for joint hypermobility, and since then a number of other groups have confirmed these results. And I was mentioning to John and Deanna earlier before the call started that there's some very nice papers coming out in the seminars in arthritis and rheumatism from Anne de Pape's group in Belgium, confirming the high rates of autonomic symptoms in those with hypermobile EDS and in looking at the autonomic abnormalities that really confirm the results that we described back in the 1990s with the CFS patients. One of the questions is, why are these things connected? And our hypothesis that we published in 1999 is that the connective tissue laxity in blood vessels that occurs in EDS, and which is part of the reason why people with EDS have such prominent varicose veins at an early age, that this same connective tissue laxity that's there in the skin and the ligaments is also there in the blood vessels. So when they stand, the vessels are more compliant, and with this gravitational pooling of blood in the limbs, the vessels stretch even more when you're upright, so that you dump much more blood into the abdomen and the legs, and that leads to a markedly diminished blood return to the heart, and thus to the orthostatic intolerance symptoms. Others have suggested some other mechanisms. One that I don't really see at all was published in the Mayo Clinic Proceedings, and the author suggested that physical inactivity as a result of joint dislocations and pain may be disabling due to associated anxiety, depression, and a somatosensory amplification state. And this might lead to exaggerated sympathetic responses triggered by fear of pain on standing. I have yet to meet the EDS patient who had fear of pain on standing. I think most of them recognize that they can get pain in different settings, but physical inactivity itself can certainly aggravate orthostatic problems. So there's no question that that could be a contributor, but I doubt that fear is really the guiding force there. A group in Israel published something several years after our paper, and they suggested that there might be a peripheral neuropathy. There could be some other shared factor between EDS and orthostatic intolerance that we don't know about. And Holman, who's written an interesting paper that describes dynamic cervical cord compression from the excessive mobility of the spinal cord, he's suggested that that can lead to autonomic symptoms in those who have a lot of flexibility. So there are a number of mechanisms. I think this one has been supported by the work by DePape and her colleagues. So I thought to illustrate how these things tie together, I'd give you a case presentation. This is a young woman who came to see me who I think could have been picked up in adolescence with orthostatic intolerance. By the time I first saw her, she was 24, and she came in reporting fatigue, lightheadedness, and these hot flashes. And when you looked at her early history, there was a suggestion that she could have a connective tissue disorder because she was born with a congenital dislocation of her hip and needed to wear a harness for 3 months, but otherwise was fairly healthy as a child, active in gymnastics and dance, had some headaches in early adolescence, about every couple of weeks in high school, and they would get worse the longer she was sitting through the school day, and they would improve after a nap. Her doctor tried her on propranolol, one of the beta blockers, without much effect. In college, the headaches were less common when she was put on birth control pills for her menstrual cramping, but when she was in the week off the active pills, on the placebo week, she would get daily headaches. One of the aggravating factors for her headache was any upright posture, or if she was not drinking well enough, had skipped meals, or was in a lot of hot environments like the summer weather. She reported lightheadedness since her early high school years, especially when she would get up quickly from a seated position or if she was standing still for any length of time. And one of the places that she was noticing this to be a problem was in the anatomy lab when she was in school to become a physician's assistant. She had never fainted, but her vision would often go black and tunneling. And she would hear people as if they were at a distance, and that's a very common feature just before you faint. One of the postural maneuvers she made was to bring her knees to her chest when she was sitting, and she would, in fact, study lying down. If she was standing, she was always fidgeting and moving around and shifting her weight. Hands and feet often looked purple, like you saw in that earlier slide, and she often had a sensation of warmth or heat when she was upright for long periods, which we think is related to surges of epinephrine. It gives you a sensation like a hot flash. So she came to see me because she was really worried about having to stand for long periods of time in her clinical rotations in PA school. She reported initially that her energy was fairly good. I think she modified that later. She could easily, just sitting there, pop her shoulders in and out of the socket. Heart rate was okay, supine, would go up to the 90s as she was walking around during the day. And this was a young woman that nobody would think of as being depressed or anxious. She had a very laid-back disposition. She was a tall girl, quite thin, did not have Marfan syndrome. She did have easy eversion of the upper eyelids. She could touch her tongue to the tip of her nose, a so-called Gorlin sign. And when we asked her about things that she could do, she could touch her tongue to her elbow and put her leg behind her head, something that's familiar to many of you. Her Biten score was 7, indicating clear hypermobility. And she had a bit of a lumbar lordosis. The cardiac exam was normal. She'd already had an echocardiogram, and that was normal. So we stood her up, and her heart rate went up 51 beats per minute, up to almost 150 just standing. And that provoked the same symptoms she came in with, including an increase in her respiratory rate and the depth of breathing, this orthostatic shortness of breath. So we diagnosed her with POTS. And of the treatments that you might think about, these two are vasoconstrictors, midodrine and methylphenidate or Ritalin. The beta blocker and mestinon can affect the catecholamines. We wondered about resuming the birth control pills because they'd been helpful to her earlier. Desmopressin acetate is a drug that's used to keep water in the vascular space, and there are other treatments you could think of. What we did for her was we had her resume the birth control pills because stopping them had been associated with increased symptoms, And Kathy Baim in Toledo, Ohio, has shown that in people with recurrent fainting, birth control pills can be a very good treatment. We also thought a beta blocker would help given how high her heart rate went and how much she was affected by these epinephrine surges and hot flashes. So she wrote me back after about a month or so, and she said the atenolol at a very low dose of 12.5 milligrams seems to be working well. My upright heart rate is lower. Hot flashes are significantly less frequent. No headaches. She was exercising better. And didn't have any side effects. So we, even though her heart rate was a bit on the lowish side compared to normal, we like to see it between 50 and 60. We bumped up the atenolol just to 25 milligrams, which is still quite a low dose. And she continued to do well, but as the temperature got warmer, she got more lightheadedness and tiredness. She then added midodrine as a vasoconstrictor with a big benefit on energy. Her sibling also has POTS and hypermobility and was on dexedrine for that, another stimulant medication. And she really got much better on the dexedrine and the atenolol. She felt 100% better. But like with a lot of stimulants, she had some appetite suppression from the dexedrine and now only uses it on days when she's upright for longer periods of time. And she takes the midodrine on other days. I wish everybody was that easy to treat, but I wanted to give you a case example of somebody who has EDS and for whom these medications really made a nice difference in her quality of life. So let's go on to the last part, which is about treating orthostatic intolerance. We start by explaining and demystifying the problem. We don't want people thinking that they're horribly ill and about to die just because they feel like they're going to die when they're standing. This is not a life-threatening problem. We provide regular clinical visits for medical monitoring and to answer questions and to provide guidance about new treatments. And especially for the children who are in school, they often need letters for accommodation like having fluids at the desk, extra time for their tests, flexibility with deadlines in case they get ill and can't make a test. And some of them need home and hospital schooling or full-time homeschooling. We begin with non-pharmacologic measures, meaning trying to address anything that anything short of what you need medication for. And we want patients, where possible, to avoid the things that bring on their symptoms. And this is pretty obvious. Going back to the original diagram, remember that people will get increased pooling and reduced volume and increased levels of epinephrine and norepinephrine. So we'll look at the things that can affect those three variables. So the things that involve increased pooling or decreased blood volume include really prolonged sitting or standing. So you want to avoid that. You want to avoid standing in line at the grocery store when you're shopping. So one of the suggestions is you shop at non-peak hours. You want to avoid warm environments. So these are not patients who should be taking a super hot shower, and certainly not right before they're supposed to go off to school or work. We often shift the showering to evening. They cannot tolerate the NIH recommendation that everyone cut down on sodium. In fact, if you take somebody with low blood pressure and you sodium restrict them, they will get fatigued, trouble thinking, and become quite symptomatic. We know that prolonged bed rest leads to deconditioning, and that those things can decrease blood volume. So this is a really challenging area in treating orthostatic intolerance. You've got to get people up and moving. If you have varicose veins, that's another way in which blood can pool in the peripheral circulation. Some people think that high carbohydrate meals are a problem. Certain medications and alcohol are vasodilators. We know that people get flushed when they drink alcohol. They also pee a lot more, so they're reducing their volume that way. So where possible, you want to avoid the things that can aggravate these symptoms. We also know that the increase in catecholamines, epinephrine and norepinephrine, will aggravate the problem. So that includes just about any form of stress. So to the extent that stress-modifying practices help, we encourage that. Exercise can increase catecholamines as well, although we want people to be able to exercise. Pain can increase epinephrine levels, as can hypoglycemia, so people need to eat frequent small meals. And asthma medications like albuterol and epinephrine will increase problems for those with orthostatic intolerance, making them quite shaky. So we try to avoid using these to the extent we can, relying instead on inhaled anti-inflammatory medications for the asthmatics. An old-time method for improving blood volume was to raise the head of the bed. This is from a paper in the 1940s, and you can see this man's hospital bed was raised up on these chairs, and he even had a little mattress insert as a speed bump so he didn't fall down. This study has been replicated more recently by Wouter Wieling's group in the Netherlands, and all you need is about a 10 to 15 degree increase in the angle of the frame. Basically, this fools the kidney into thinking it's a bit the person is volume depleted, and so you don't make as much urine at night. You've got more fluid in the blood vessels in the morning. We also use compression garments. Support hose in the 30 to 40 millimeter mercury range are really quite tight, sometimes a bit tough to get on, but around 30 millimeters is often a bit more comfortable. The more area you cover with the compression garments, the better. So waist-high compression stockings are better than knee-highs. Recently, body shaper garments have been a really nice addition to the armamentarium, especially for the young women. And these are the things like the Spanx and other body shaper garments that provide a lot of abdominal compression. You can also get a plain abdominal binder, and I'll show you some pictures of these next. Here's the kind of upper abdomen to thigh level compression garment. This person has 30 millimeter mercury stockings, so they don't need to be like your grandmother's stockings. They can be rather stylish. This is about a $15 abdominal binder that has a Velcro way of securing itself, and this can be worn under T-shirts fairly unobtrusively. These are some stockings that have special compression for when you're on the airplane, and even some of the athletic compression garments can be good for improving upright posture. The other thing is people need to use postural countermaneuvers, and here's a picture of a young woman standing in what we call a cocktail party pose where your legs are crossed over, and that uses the muscles of the leg as a pump where we're saying that if the vessels are not constricting adequately on their own, squeeze them from outside using the muscles. And we'll often find that people have adopted postures like sitting with their knees up to their chest. They lean forward while they're sitting. They can clench their fists when standing up to get some blood pumped out of the arms. And even sitting, you can elevate your knees on a footrest, and that will help improve blood volume. With regard to fluid intake, we want people drinking at least 2 liters a day, but we don't want them drinking 4 to 6 liters usually. That's often too much. We want them drinking at least every couple of hours. Don't guzzle a liter in the morning and a liter at bedtime. That won't do you much good. Kids need access to fluids at school. We also want to have people avoid sleeping for more than 12 hours a day. Now, why would that be? Well, we want them to make sure that they are not staying in bed for so long that they get incredibly dehydrated. If you sleep for 14 to 16 hours, you'll become so dehydrated that when you get out of bed, you'll immediately trigger an episode of lightheadedness and fatigue. Cooling garments can be very helpful in the hot weather. With regard to salt, we simply suggest that people increase their salt intake according to taste, supplemented with salt tablets, and it doesn't have to be junk food. It can be things that are healthy, like salsa, pretzels, soy sauce. Salt is very important. It can't just be water intake. Exercise is tough because you want to avoid excessive bed rest and sleeping, but if you do too much too soon, you increase your fatigue level. So for people who are really impaired, we recommend that they start their exercise slowly, sometimes beginning with recumbent exercise, and that they increase really gradually. We think that manual forms of physical therapy are a very good bridge to better tolerance of exercise when people start off quite impaired. And the message we give our patients is that inactivity is the enemy. And often what we'll hear back from them is they'll say, the more I do, the more I can do. In other words, the more you are able to push to do things, the better your blood volume and stamina become. Here's a physiology paper from some studies at NASA showing that if you put people on complete bed rest, and this was an extraordinary study of 220 days of complete bed rest, not even getting up to urinate. And the thing I want to draw your attention to is in the first 2 to 3 weeks, people lost about 9 to 15% of their plasma volume. And you can easily imagine that if you feel really lousy after surgery or after mono or some other infection and you're in bed a lot, not moving much, and you get a drop in blood volume of 12 to 15%, you're going to be in trouble with your orthostatic tolerance. If you lose 12% of your blood volume on one day, you're going to be in shock. So this is a pretty profound consequence of inactivity. Let's talk briefly about the contributory conditions. There are a number of things that go into aggravating orthostatic intolerance, so it's not one thing for each person. And so we want people to be working with their physicians and thinking through the other things that can aggravate problems. For example, depression can make you dizzy, or some of the older treatments for depression can make you dizzy. Also, if your orthostatic intolerance is horrible, then you'll become depressed secondarily. Anxiety can interact with orthostatic intolerance. One of the ways of bringing on a panic attack experimentally is to use isoproterenol infusions, which we use on tilt testing to trigger fainting. So there's an interesting interaction between these two. We find food allergies, especially delayed hypersensitivity to milk protein in a lot of our patients, so we look to get them off milk. We try to control their allergies and asthma and make sure any infections are treated. Many of them, even when hypermobile, have focal areas of restricted movement. Migraines can aggravate orthostatic intolerance. The EDS audience knows a lot about Chiari malformation and cervical spine stenosis as another way that autonomic symptoms can be provoked. And some people have pelvic vein varicoses, ovarian vein varicoses that lead to what's called pelvic congestion syndrome. This is typically more common in women who've had pregnancies, but we've seen it even in adolescents who've never been pregnant. And it's another way, another set of vessels where blood can pool. On to the medications. We start with trying to get one medicine that'll figure out the problem for each person, but usually move to what I call rational polytherapy. And if we go back to our guideline, you can address the vasoconstriction with the problem with vasoconstriction with better vasoconstrictor drugs. You can address the low intravascular volume with volume expanders, and you can reduce the catecholamine release or effect. Of the drugs that will do that, the vasoconstrictors, we mentioned midodrine earlier, the stimulants like dexedrine and methylphenidate, and then also some of the drugs used for different reasons, typically, like the serotonin reuptake inhibitors like Zoloft and Prozac and Lexapro, or the SNRI drugs like duloxetine or Cymbalta. Those medications have some ability to vasoconstrict. So just because somebody gets put on, say, Zoloft, by a doctor that thinks they have atypical depression doesn't mean that it was that they truly had depression, because if they get better, it could be the vasoconstrictor effect. Volume expanders can include the higher sodium that we were talking about, that's orally and sometimes IV saline. Florinef or fludrocortisone is an important one. Clonidine can work for selected patients, although my colleagues in Norway in Vigard-Willer's group just published a paper suggesting that if you get clonidine for chronic fatigue syndrome, it makes kids worse. We mentioned birth control pills as another way of expanding volume, and desmopressin has been shown in short physiology studies anyway to help with improving the response to standing. Beta blockers are the mainstay of way of reducing the catecholamine release or effect, and mestinon or pyridostigmine bromide is a very helpful medication for some patients. I'm going to skip this one because it's really the same message. This question comes up a lot. How do we select the initial therapy? And you can go with an algorithm or an individualized approach. And the algorithm is like this, published by the groups at the Mayo Clinic. Everybody gets hydration, salt intake, support stockings, education and demystification, and exercise. Then pharmacologically, they suggest as a first-line agent for everybody with POTS, either a beta blocker or midodrine, leaving Florinef as a second-line drug and the others as rarely being used. The approach we've taken is to try and individualize the treatment of each patient. So if the systolic blood pressure is on the low side of normal, we'll usually begin with Florinef or midodrine. If they have a markedly increased heart rate at baseline, like the young PA school student I showed you, or with tilt, we'll try them on a beta blocker first. But we also look for other clinical clues. So if I have a patient who has a salt shaker at the bedside and pours some salt out on his hand and licks it, that guy's going to get Florinef first. If they have headaches, because beta blockers are good as migraine preventive drugs, we might try a beta blocker first. If it's a young woman who's got a lot of menstrual cramping and terrible fatigue with her menstrual periods, we'll try a birth control pill or Depo-Provera. If they have a tremendous amount of anxiety or some depression as a secondary phenomenon, we might try one of the antidepressants. If they've got prominent muscle pain, sometimes Cymbalta is helpful. And in the hypermobile population, we've had a lot of luck using stimulants or midodrine with the idea that if their vessels are really stretchy, you've got to find a pharmacologic way to make them constrict better. And similarly, if we get somebody who's got a family history of attention deficit disorder, we'll likely try a stimulant to treat their orthostatic intolerance. And just a little bit, this is the next to last slide, that the management of this problem really requires a lot of trial and error, careful attention by the patient and the practitioner to the things that bring on their symptoms, a willingness to try a number of different medications before you achieve a good fit, and we have to recognize that medications often treat the symptoms but don't necessarily cure the orthostatic intolerance, much like we think about treating asthma. We don't expect to set out to cure asthma, but we want to manage the symptoms so that people have an active life. And this needs to be part of a comprehensive program of care, which I think everybody in the EDS community understands. Just a picture to show you some of the gratifying parts for a physician of treating kids with these problems. Here's a girl doing her a skydiving episode, not what we recommend, but a good indication that she was doing better. Here's a young woman with Ehlers-Danlos syndrome who really did well with manual physical therapy and a little bit of medication help, but she's now able to be in the reserves. These are a couple of patients who sent me pictures of their completion of 5Ks or half marathons. I want to acknowledge the people who've helped me do my work. I've had a very important person helping me as a volunteer. This is a research assistant, Colleen Martin, whose daughter is a patient in my clinic, and Colleen's been terrific at helping me do data entry and conducting studies. We've been very fortunate to have a number of really clever summer students, Marissa Flaherty, who just graduated from medical school, Samantha Jason, who's studying to become an occupational therapist, Erica Cranston, who's applying to med school, as is Jocelyn Ray. We've been supported by the Sunshine Natural Wellbeing Foundation, who support my academic activities. And I don't think we could have continued to work on these problems with chronic fatigue and orthostatic intolerance and EDS without a number of families who've been very generous, including Bill and Vicki Boyce, the Bowen family, the Cornells, the Caldwells, the Kelly and Kylie families, the McFerrins, Newgrand, Smith family, and a couple of the students who did fundraisers for us. So I'm going to stop there. And, John, I gather this is the time for the Q&A?
Yes, it is. And we do have 10 questions as a starter for you. Okay. And you Great. Should be able to click on the Q&A and read those questions and give them answers. So I appreciate
okay.
it. This has been a very informative discussion and in a lot of depth, which I think our EDS community enjoys and appreciates that level of detail. So looking forward to your answering our questions.
Very good. Well, I'll read these out. Somebody's saying, even though I now know I had symptoms for many years, I only recently had a tilt test. The diagnosis is POTS, orthostatic hypotension, and neurocardiogenic syncope. Are these all the same condition or separate conditions? Well, let's start with that one. They're different in some ways. Each of these is an orthostatic intolerance, and each of them probably involves some of the same features, like not getting enough blood flow up to the brain when you're standing. The difference is in how long you can remain standing. The people with pure orthostatic hypotension, by definition, have had a plummeting of their blood pressure in the first 3 minutes. They often, but not always, have other conditions like Parkinson's disease, diabetes, or other things that you'll see. Any one of us could get immediate orthostatic hypotension if we had a sudden hemorrhage. So you can get orthostatic hypotension in the middle of an acute medical illness, but we typically just view that as a consequence of that illness, not a long-term problem. With neurocardiogenic syncope, as I mentioned, the time to dropping your blood pressure is many minutes longer. And with POTS, you may late in an upright test develop a drop in blood pressure, but usually the significant thing there is the increase in heart rate early on. The good thing is that many of them are treated in the same way. The second question that's asked is, I've taken the beta blockers Medicare will cover, atenolol and metoprolol, with disabling side effects. And I'll just respond there that you have to be aware that with any one of these medications, you can get lots of side effects, and it just is a reminder that you can't, that no one size fits all, and that if you get those kinds of disabling problems like fatigue and lightheadedness on a beta blocker, you have to move on. And the follow-up question was whether the PCP is on track suggesting fludrocortisone or Florinef or midodrine. Well, I think those sound like reasonable options if somebody really doesn't react well to the atenolol or the other beta blocker. They all work a little bit differently, and so these are reasonable things to try. Second question is that my daughter has POTS and EDS. She dances. She complains about burning, tingling in her feet, and sometimes her hands, especially in the feet, and says it's worse at night. What can help? Not sure what that might be, but it has a bit of a neurologic feel to it, as if, you know, we think of numbness and tingling as features that are present if a nerve is either being pinched or is under some kind of mechanical strain. And so having her looked at by a good physical therapist might be an idea or at least something to discuss, but I'd certainly bring this to the attention of her physician. We know that some of those kinds of symptoms are relatively easily treated, and some can be features of more serious neurosurgical problems, so it's important to get a good evaluation. The next question is from somebody who says, this is a novice question. My daughter was diagnosed with POTS with hypermobility and EDS based on the Biten score and not sure what else. The question is, how important is it to get officially tested and know which type of EDS you have, who does that kind of testing, and is it only done by a geneticist? Those are questions probably beyond my pay grade as a general pediatrician, but I'll tell you what we've done. I think it's pretty easy to diagnose people who have hypermobile EDS. And those who have the classical form because of the skin changes that they get. The one that really counts for everybody is the vascular form. And because of the potential for vessel and hollow organ rupture, those patients to some extent have some characteristic facial features, but they can be evaluated by geneticists. As long as we're pretty sure that the family history is negative for the vascular form, and my genetics colleagues will need to chime in on this, I would think the diagnosis of hypermobile EDS isn't always going to need a geneticist, as long as it's somebody familiar with connective tissue disorders, either a rheumatologist, somebody who sees a lot of patients with these disorders. I would suspect that in the medical community we have a number of different ways of answering that question, and some may feel that every patient with this needs to be seen by a geneticist. I don't know, though, given the suggestion that joint hypermobility and the hypermobile form of EDS can't be distinguished, I don't think there are enough geneticists to see the 20% of the normal population that meets criteria for hypermobility. So we've got a staffing and manpower problem if everybody has to be seen. Okay, next person says, I have been eating up to half a watermelon a day for the past month with improvement in pooling in the legs. Is this something I can continue? I don't know what that would be doing, but it's a really interesting observation, and I think I can't imagine anything about eating watermelon that would be harmful. So why not continue that? The interesting thing would be to figure out what watermelon has in it that might have a vasoconstricting effect or that might improve blood volume in some fashion. So you may have caught on to something that's important. It would be nice to see some research on that. Next question is sensory overload in vision and hearing happening due to autonomic nervous system disruption? I don't know that we know exactly the cause of that, but there's often the sense that in people who are fairly impaired and have a lot of autonomic dysfunction that there's an amplification of sensory signals in people with a variety of conditions like EDS, fibromyalgia, chronic fatigue syndrome. So it might be then aggravated by autonomic nervous system input, but that one's a tougher one and probably better answered by a neurologist. Next question is, what do you think the relationship is between craniocervical instability and Chiari malformation with orthostatic intolerance in patients with EDS type 3? As many of you know, especially those who go to the ED&F conferences and have heard talks by Dr. Henderson, he and others have found that there are with these forms of craniocervical instability, symptoms can be markedly worse, and what we see in the affected patients is a lot of autonomic dysfunction, a lot of orthostatic intolerance, and our observations informally have been that these problems often improve when the underlying cervical instability or the Chiari malformation is managed better. Chiari malformation was described for many years as presenting with neurally mediated syncope or NMH-type fainting. And it's probably the case that there are a lot of vascular control centers that are being affected by direct pressure in conditions with a lot of crowding at the base of the brain. Next question is, an EDS hypermobility patient has worse orthostatic symptoms when on any blood volume increasers, so volumizers. Any ideas why? Well, I'm not sure about why that might be. We will sometimes see that if we put people on Florinef, when they have excessively distensible vessels, then they can, the vessels just keep stretching out and they gain an excessive amount of water weight. It doesn't happen for everybody on Florinef, which is one of the blood volume drugs, but it can. So for those patients, we just have them switch to something else. In an EDS patient who's worse on things that improve blood volume, I'd look to try something that has the ability to improve their vasoconstriction. The follow-up points out that one of the drugs was Florinef that made her worse. The other one was midodrine. Well, we can also see the same with midodrine. So the key with these medications is to keep trying examples from different pharmacological classes until you find something that works. Meanwhile, making sure that you're really being fastidious about drinking adequately water and electrolyte solutions, making sure your salt intake is good, and dealing with the basics, including using compression garments if you tolerate those. Next question is an interesting one. Most of these management strategies are geared toward young adults and adults. What would you change in recommendations for treating young children, say a four-year-old? Really not much. You know, Florinef has been used for many years for patients who have adrenal insufficiency on a genetic basis. So it can be used at that age. Virtually all of the medications we recommend have been used in young kids. We obviously want to select medications for those who are not responding to the more conservative dietary measures and fluids. But for some of the young kids we've seen with orthostatic intolerance, one boy I remember in particular was a kid who, anytime the weather warmed up and he would go out at daycare and kindergarten for the playtime, he would really be so heat intolerant that he'd have to come back inside. Well, one of the ways of treating him was to get him a little bandana that was soaked in ice water and a hat that had a cooling device in it, and that helped him stay outside in the hot weather a bit better. Next, the question is, I have EDS. Our adult son has some EDS symptoms but hasn't wanted to go to be evaluated for EDS. He has exercise intolerance, had a workup done by a cardiologist who found something mild, but I was concerned that our son might have orthostatic intolerance. His heart rate increases pretty rapidly upon exercising to the point that he can't run as an exercise, and he has always felt lightheaded when standing up from a chair. He said he mentioned this to his doctor, who told him that happens to many people, and the doctor acted like it wasn't a big deal, didn't order a tilt test. Is it somewhat normal to have the lightheadedness upon standing, or do you think all of this is grounds for doing a tilt table test? That actually is a great question that gets at one of the other conditions I didn't mention. There's something called instantaneous orthostatic hypotension that we don't usually detect if we're checking blood pressure each minute, but which you can detect if you're checking it on a beat-to-beat monitor. And typically this will occur in a number of adolescents. They stand up and they get a bit of a visual blackout, some lightheadedness, but it goes away spontaneously and they don't have chronic symptoms. So most people think that all you need to do with instantaneous orthostatic hypotension is tell people what it is and give them some postural countermaneuvers when they stand. However, if you've got exercise intolerance and lightheadedness on a chronic basis, you know, the lightheadedness you get with standing is not this simple, benign form, and is the kind of thing that we think needs to be investigated because it's so easy to treat. If he's reasonably active, the patients who are less deconditioned are often the easiest to treat because they don't have muscle weakness superimposed on all the other problems. And so getting them going on simple things like a higher salt intake and watching their fluids and so on and thinking about use of medications might improve the kinds of activities that they can then tolerate. Next question, do I know of any literature or studies which support complementary and alternative medicine as a non-pharmacologic option to treat POTS? Examples include acupuncture, craniosacral therapy, and so on. And there are actually a couple of medicines in the alternative medicine community that mimic what we use in more standard pharmacologic ways. For example, licorice root, which is an old remedy that's in a lot of Chinese herbal mixes, licorice root will raise blood pressure. When I was in medical school and we were studying causes of hypertension, one of them was excessive licorice intake. So licorice has this property very much like Florinef that will raise blood pressure, and most licorice on the market now has had that active ingredient removed, but the licorice root in the herbal places can have a Florinef-like effect. It reminds you to make sure that if your blood pressure is too high on a variety of things, that one of the reasons isn't an unknown intake of licorice root in an herbal supplement. There are also some herbal supplements that are used for treating varicose veins. One of them is horse chestnut seed extract. So if you go in most supermarkets and you find these over-the-counter things for varicose veins, they'll include a vasoconstricting herb. Then going on to acupuncture, we try that a fair bit, haven't had a ton of success, but I know a few people are improved by acupuncture, and it's relatively harmless. So I have no objection when people want to try that. We use a lot of the manual therapy techniques that have been used in osteopathic care, like craniosacral therapy, and that are used by a lot of manual physical therapists. I think these are a big help. We don't understand all of the mechanisms by which they do aid people, but I think that kind of gentle manual therapy has been very important in the treatment of our patients. Sometimes it gets at things that you can't touch with medication. With regard to chiropractic treatment, we try to avoid, especially in the hypermobile population, the rapid thrust type of manipulations that chiropractors often do, thinking that that makes hypermobile segments worse and more unstable. But not all chiropractors use the rapid thrust techniques on their EDS patients, and they use a variety of manual treatments that probably work. There haven't been formal studies, but I know of one case report that's about to come out from a cardiologist in the Philadelphia area, and his osteopathic colleague reporting that POTS was, in fact, completely alleviated with craniosacral manipulation. So there's, I think, a lot more work that needs to be done there. Next question is, instead of taking stimulants, can a patient drink a small amount of Mountain Dew per day? And that's from somebody who is in the president's office at the Mountain Dew Corporation. Just kidding. Good question as well, because the stimulant medications have a vasoconstricting property. So does caffeine. the dilemma is that caffeine makes some people just too shaky and jittery, and it also can have a diuretic effect. So you can counteract whatever you're gaining from the vasoconstricting effect of the caffeine because you're peeing out too much fluid. I tell people to take a look at what caffeine does for them and use it in moderation, but it can be a helpful adjunct. Many of us think that one of the changes in society that's led to an increase in orthostatic intolerance is not only that we've cut back on salt intake as a population, but that we've also reduced the amount of smoking. And nicotine, for example, is a very powerful vasoconstrictor, and we think that some people with orthostatic intolerance and fatigue self-medicated in the past by drinking multiple cups of coffee a day and by chain smoking. Not that we would recommend doing that, but it really gives you some insight into one of the changes in society that might have contributed to the big increase in prevalence of these problems. Next question. Orthostatic hypertension occurs in hyperadrenergic POTS. Would a stimulant be okay to use? Great question. The thought behind why blood pressure increases when you stand in those with POTS is that you've got such a high blood concentration of the catecholamines, like norepinephrine, that will cause a vessel constriction and an increase in blood pressure. Would it be okay to use a stimulant in that setting? Well, if the increase in the catecholamines is triggered by excessive pooling in the first place, the stimulant or the drug like midodrine might be a very good way of preventing the hyperadrenergic phenomenon from occurring. Sometimes we've seen orthostatic hypertension responding to a saline bolus, which tests this notion that really the problem is that they're pooling too much blood in the periphery and they're not getting enough blood up to the brain. And when you tank them up with saline, they're getting enough blood flow to the brain. The brain doesn't over-respond by a marked increase in the sympathetic nervous system output. Then there's a question about migraines and anxiety issues. Not sure what that's connected to. I'm going to skip that one. I'm sorry, not quite sure I understand what the question is. Next one, my daughter's 15. She has POTS and hypermobile EDS, has a lot of fatigue, sleeps more than 12 hours a day. Symptoms are worse during her period. Should we try putting her on the birth control pill? If so, which one? I can't give you direct advice about an individual patient, but there are a couple of things that we do in those who sleep too long. We wake them up after about 10 or 12 hours just to get them better hydrated. If they need to lie back down later, fine, but at least they're doing so while hydrated and not worsening the orthostatic intolerance. And then just in very general terms, if people get way worse fatigue and other symptoms of orthostatic intolerance during their period, we often put them on a birth control pill. And if that's not sufficient, one of the techniques that's become more common is to use continuous dosing of the active pill. So instead of 21 days of an active pill followed by 7 days of the placebo, which then induces the period, we'll put them on 84 days of the active hormone, which gives them one period every 3 months. So they then have a third fewer episodes where their symptoms are getting worse. So that can be a strategy that you might want to discuss with your physician in that setting. Somebody writes, I was diagnosed with EDS and POTS in the last 7 months. The doctor said no cure. Just exercise, and I don't have anyone treating me. So clearly, exercise is important and has been emphasized by some groups that really involve people in really quite vigorous exercise, sometimes beginning with recumbent rowing. We think a recumbent bike is another good way of treating people who are pretty intolerant of upright positions like being on a treadmill. But we think the medications end up being a nice bridge to allowing people to exercise in the way we would like them to do. And I think the danger with the overemphasis on exercise alone is that it starts to blame patients for problems that are beyond their control. And I've had students who were unable to continue at Johns Hopkins University who then went to physical therapy. They were working on exercising as much as they could, but they just couldn't manage. We found the right medication for one of them, and within a month she was able to do incredible things like kayaking and doing a 5K run after 2 months. So in her case, it wasn't a lack of desire to exercise. It was an unstable physiology that we improved with a better medication choice. And then once she was able to exercise, she's actually been much steadier, doesn't need her compression garments as much. So the key is to make sure you're not being too heavy-handed with the exercise recommendation. Next question is from somebody who says, I'm 34. I was diagnosed 10 years ago with CFS and 2 years ago with POTS and EDS. Midodrine has worked relatively well. I still have a great deal of concentration issues, and I've often joked with friends and family that I'm ADD due to the lack of ability to concentrate. Even with midodrine, would a stimulant like dexedrine be a better option? Would this provide further assistance with combating fatigue more so than midodrine? Well, very good question. I think I'm a big proponent of trying the stimulants. There are several small randomized trials in Europe showing that the stimulants, either dexedrine or methylphenidate, which is Ritalin, are helpful for people with chronic fatigue syndrome. And, there just haven't been huge trials suggesting their efficacy. I know there's another one going on the West Coast with, I think it's methylphenidate and some other nutritional or mitochondrial supplement. But so there should be more work on this in the research area. But we find that you've got to be careful with the combination of midodrine and dexedrine. They're both working as a technique of improving vasoconstriction, and sometimes they work too well together and drive blood pressure up too high. So if somebody's already on midodrine and they want to add a stimulant like dexedrine or switch to it, switching is obviously less problematic. But if you add the stimulant to the midodrine, you just have to make sure that the blood pressure is not going up excessively. The key is to find something that works, and you just have to be willing to experiment a bit. Another question on says, can you comment on orthostatic intolerance in the clinical context of mast cell activation and EDS hypermobility type? So many of the symptoms are similar. Is this a chicken and egg phenomenon? Would one tackle this, getting the immune system stable before tackling other therapies, given how reactive this group of patients is to medications? So that's an area of really emerging interest as people are looking at the overlap. When you read monographs on mast cell activation disorder, often people have been misdiagnosed with chronic fatigue syndrome, and probably misdiagnosis is the wrong term. They meet the criteria for chronic fatigue syndrome, but you can have more than one thing with CFS, as those with EDS and CFS know. I think we need a lot more work in this area to know who should be treated, which patients we ought to be targeting. But the good thing is that the mast cell activation treatments are fairly benign, things like antihistamines or ranitidine, which is Zantac, even chromalin sodium, is something that has very few side effects. The real question is, how do we pick the right patient for whom that should receive these medications? We certainly find a lot of food allergy in our patients with chronic fatigue syndrome. We're about to publish something that says that up to a third of the adolescents have delayed hypersensitivity to milk protein. And unless we get that allergen out of their diet, none of the medications work very effectively. So getting at the driving force for each patient in the symptoms, the driving force of the orthostatic intolerance is important if you can identify something that is a factor. One question, can the tilt table test drive dysautonomia into high gear? It shouldn't have a prolonged negative effect, but it certainly will make people worse while they're on the table and sometimes for several days after. In fact, that was such a problem when we began doing the tilt testing for people with CFS that we started treating them with a liter of normal saline right after the test was completed. They'd come in feeling lousy. We'd make them feel horrible on the tilt test, and then after the saline, they often felt better than when they came in. And this served an educational purpose of reminding them how reversible some of the symptoms are and that they could work on higher salt and fluid intake themselves and try to approximate what the IV saline did. Next question, have we had any success with patients following the cardiac rehab protocol recommended out of Texas? I don't have much direct experience with that. But I know that there is at least a subset of people who do seem to improve with vigorous exercise. One would have to wonder if they're the ones that have fewer overall comorbid conditions and had just kind of gotten into a mistaken or improper response after something like mono, and they were just lying around in bed too much, because when they are upright, they felt so unwell with the lightheadedness. Those patients who don't have a lot of other conditions probably do respond better to the more vigorous exercise protocols. But the problem is there's a lot of discussion about these things and a lot of anecdote, but not much evidence for us to pick sensibly which technique is the best and for which subset of patients. Next question is, somebody has MS causing POTS. Do we see this cause of autonomic dysfunction, and would treatment be similar for patients with EDS? I don't see much MS, multiple sclerosis, in the pediatric patients I deal with, but one would think that if there is autonomic dysfunction, no matter what the other condition, that some of the same treatments would be similar like the ones we talked about here. We all have the same list of medications to pick from, we're trying, even in somebody with MS who has autonomic dysfunction, we're trying to improve their orthostatic tolerance with the same medications. The next person is describing orthostatic vital signs in a 4-year-old with EDS. The supine heart rate is 93, with standing 109, and then after 5 minutes of standing, the blood pressure's dropped from 111 to 88, and the heart rate's down, irritable and complaining he couldn't stand anymore. That seems more like the neurally mediated hypotension kind of response. So getting that evaluated is tough to do tilt tests and standing tests in the really young population. We don't usually try doing tilt tests in the kids under 10 because they don't stay still, and you have to go more with clinical impressions and common sense. The child has gut dysmotility and hydronephrosis of the kidney, and probably just is a four-year-old who doesn't want to cooperate. Any other recommendations? Yeah, I mean, with those are some challenging situations. Sometimes you can try these compression suits, and maybe make the child feel like this is something special, like maybe a special outfit that a superhero would wear. So you're kind of cajoling them into wearing what are really compression garments, but they're wearing them because they look like a fun costume. And beyond that, it's a matter of, you know, seeing whether the physicians think medications are in order. Next question is, I didn't erase it. Okay, somebody's been using half a teaspoon of baking soda with 8 ounces of water after meals for reflux. Does baking soda count as salt? No, I'm a lousy chemist. I'm going to skip that one because I'm not sure of my standing on that. Why do sleep disruptions occur? I often awaken suddenly with heart rate surges, overheating, short of breath, or chills that radiate from the spine. Is this common in OI patients' possible causes? Hard to know what might be triggering that. We worry if we're seeing somebody with symptoms about 4 or 5 hours after they ate something that they're allergic to, like, say, a bowl of ice cream, for those who are milk intolerant, they can get night sweats and feel short of breath in bed. So I'd want to see if they have the cardinal features of milk protein hypersensitivity of a delayed sort, not the anaphylactic type. Those patients usually have abdominal pain, bad reflux, and early satiety, so they feel full easily. Sometimes they have mouth ulcers. So you want to try and remove something that might be aggravating the symptoms. But there's also a group that think that sympathetic tone is very high at night. There's some research suggesting that, and some of you may have heard Alan Posinke, an internist in the Washington area, talk about this, where he thinks that heart rate and sympathetic tone are very high at night so that it doesn't take much of an increase in heart rate to get you to the point of arousing or being awakened. And those patients can often feel very forceful cardiac contractions and have some problems with being overheated. And he's recommended low doses of propranolol, which is a short-acting beta blocker, at bedtime. And for some people, that helps improve the autonomic tone at night, so their heart rate's lower, they don't wake up as easily, and they feel better during the day. At least many of the patients Alan describes have had that response. Similar reaction can occur if you take clonidine, as another drug that reduces central nervous system outflow in the sympathetic nervous system. So depends a bit on the patient. There might be other factors that contribute to nighttime symptoms, including the position you get into in sleep. Is that putting a strain on the nervous system in some fashion? Another good question. I've heard of people using IV fluids when needed. When should a patient with POTS consider trying IV fluids? Well, there are a couple of things about that are important. One is that there are papers from the 1980s from Cleveland showing that if you put people in with POTS who have hyperadrenergic POTS, and in some ways all POTS is hyperadrenergic, right? Everybody has a high catecholamine level. The hyperadrenergic label is used for the ones with extremely high levels. And when they were given IV saline in an experimental situation, their POTS improved. Others have shown that if you give big boluses of saline, you modulate autonomic tone and you improve the amount of time people can be upright. Now, IV fluids are expensive. We tend to restrict them to the patients who are having a flare-up in symptoms triggered by, say, a sinus infection, or they're just not getting back to their baseline after an infectious illness. Or occasionally we'll use them like we did in May for a patient with EDS or connective tissue problems and POTS who was getting married. So she got her saline the morning of the wedding, and that allowed her to be upright during this really important social occasion. We'll do it sometimes for the teenagers who are trying to get to prom, just to try and normalize some of their social experiences. Every now and then, and rarely in my clinic, we have somebody whose only way of maintaining function is weekly saline. For them, for the ones who can come in and have a vein found by the nurses each week, that's great. Once you shift over to PICC lines and central lines like porticaths, you increase the risk of bacterial infection and sepsis. So that has to be taken into careful consideration. I know there's some colleagues who use a lot more IV fluids than I do, and conversely, some colleagues who are horrified by the amount of IV fluid we use ourselves. My goal is to improve the patient's function, and if giving them the IV saline keeps them active more, they're not going to get quite as deconditioned. Next is a question from Deanna that we'd arranged to have her remind me of if I didn't mention it. And these were the studies from Belgium by Anne de Pape's group. Anne de Pape is one of the premier geneticists in the world dealing with EDS. One is a paper in which she talks about autonomic symptom burden in the hypermobile EDS patients, comparing them with other types of EDS. And the conclusion or the results were that the total autonomic symptom burden was higher in the hypermobile EDS patients than in controls and those with classical or vascular EDS. It was comparable in the hypermobile type patients to patients with fibromyalgia who have a lot of orthostatic intolerance as well. Orthostatic and GI complaints or gastrointestinal complaints were prevalent. Other paper, so this their finding was that these symptoms are pretty common extra articular manifestations of EDS and contribute to the lowered quality of life and the fatigue. Then a second paper looked more at the autonomic measurements, and they showed the higher sympathetic activity at rest and in response to different stimuli. They showed that orthostatic intolerance was significantly more prevalent in the hypermobile EDS patients during tilt, 74% versus 34%. It was 74% in the EDS patients, 34% in the controls, often expressed as postural tachycardia syndrome. And so they did a very nice job of confirming some of the things that have been circulating in the literature. And these are being published in the Seminars in Arthritis and Rheumatism 2014. The article is available online in press right now, so keep an eye out for those later. Another question is whether there's a link between OI, dysautonomia flares, and barometric pressure or weather changes. We certainly see that in people with migraines. That's been well recognized for a long time, and I think a lot of our orthostatic patients describe this, don't have any idea what it's from other than a pressure phenomenon that might allow more blood to pool when the environmental pressure is lower. I haven't studied that carefully, and I'm a little unsure of my understanding of the weather changes and their effect on blood pressure. Can mid-thoracic and upper back pain be related to OI, like a coat hanger syndrome? Certainly people with orthostatic hypotension can get this coat hanger type of discomfort. They can even get throat pain and sore throat with orthostatic intolerance. Another question is, would treating ovarian veins or pelvic veins with coils help long-term with abdominal pooling of blood and bloating? We had a small series that we never got published. People thought it wasn't novel enough, but we looked at a group of young people who had the ovarian varicosities. We know that that the pelvic pain certainly gets better after you put in the coils through a catheter and plug up and cause the ovarian veins to sclerose. We've had the observation that those patients also did better in terms of their energy level, but we didn't study that formally. We just knew that in the 6 months after the ovarian embolization, we got the expected improvement in their pelvic pain, but also nice improvements in their orthostatic tolerance and their energy level. Somebody's asking about the report from the osteopath. I don't think it's out yet, but I think it's coming out in one of the osteopathic journals. And then I think we're done with the questions, John.
I think we are, and we really appreciate your patience in answering all those questions as well. There were about 30 questions that went through.
Yeah, any others that you guys fielded that I missed?
Oh, thank you very much. I think you addressed a lot of different aspects that people were concerned about with their symptoms and medications and so forth. And we really appreciate all the detail that you went into. It's very valuable
Great.
For us.
So any final comments, Dr. Rowe?
No, just these are terrific questions. Everybody's really thinking at a high level, and there are a fair number of the questions that were in the Q&A session that could be the basis of some very nice research studies if we could get a few more people interested in these topics. So congratulations to everybody, and I appreciate the interest and wish you luck with your treatments.
Okay, great. Well, we are going to wrap up. The recording will be posted on our site tomorrow. Our next presentation will be by Dr. Nielsen, and that will be on August 6th. We do have Dr. Posinki, and he will be on August 20th. So those are our schedules for August, and we'd like to appreciate you spending that time with us, and we're going to say good evening. So thank you. Good night.
Thanks for joining us. Good night.
Night.